Hello and welcome back to the next installment of Fun with Dash Cams. This is part of the experimental series. In this case, this is a experiment trying to achieve what I achieved in the previous video of 7 Alpha, which was full 360s, front back recording in HD. But I wanted to go on the lower end of probably the minimal acceptable level. And in particular, I was seeing what I could pull off with $100, but with a caveat, not purchasing online, but just what I could actually cobble together from a retail purchase. And in particular, these were actually purchased in about first part of March in 2015. It is currently the 26th of April, 2015. So I bought these a little bit over a month ago, about a month and a half ago. And I bought it from a particular retail establishment. In this case, it was a big box store known as Walmart. So I wanted to see what could I buy for about $100 to cobble together a multi-camera system, maybe with some stuff I had on hand. And this is the result. What I ended up getting was a camera which is basically the C600, and that's why I'm incorporating this as a review of the C600. I will produce a second video of the actual video samples. This is just a tabletop of the camera and the project. So as I said, this is basically a generic C600, and I will cover this particular retail example. I'm going to cover what I was trying to accomplish, which was very similar to the other, to my previous, which is my daily driver. However, scaled back on expectations because that was a project for $300. This is a project for $100 US as of March 2015. We will cover the good aspects of the project. We will recover some of the not so nice aspects, the bad, but I'll also cover the not so ugly. And this is trying to get reasonable expectations for the money I'm paying. So what did I want? I wanted dual front and back HD recording. For $100, we've automatically reduced our expectation of just exactly what we're going to pull off. As anybody will tell you, for $100 for a single camera, you should expect fairly decent daytime and average to not quite so average nighttime, but you should expect for $100 at least very good HD, probably 1080p 30 frames per second, or maybe 720 to 60 frames per second recording, depending. Like I said, $400 for a dedicated forward-facing camera. But in this case, for $100, we want front and back. So scale back, probably looking at 720p out of the cameras. I did want date timestamp. I'm not even going to consider GPS or any other, WDR, anything like that. That is out the window for this price range, given that I'm going to be using multiple cameras. But I did want to see if I could get parking or motion detection mode also working, and I did get it, but with varying results depending on what I'm trying to accomplish. I did want it, of course, to be discreet, so I'm looking towards a smaller camera, which, for $50 per camera or $40 per camera, which is what I was looking at, single camera is doable. I wanted to be able to download data remotely, and in this particular model, that was a plus because it supports USB data, unlike my other camera, which I really wanted it, but it would require a second set of cables since I also got GPS. So I traded one for the other. But I wanted the ability to pull data from the camera without having to yank cards, remove the cameras, all that kind of stuff, just because it reduces wear and tear on your setup. You really just want to set the cameras once and forget it, and ideally use the cheat that a lot of people are using, which is a 12-volt adapter to USB, and then just be able to swing the USB cable to a laptop, and then just be able to pull the data remotely, and that way you don't have to upset your total setup. Run the cables and that's it, and that way you just minimize wear and tear. Of course, I wanted the usual things with what any dash cam, anything called a dash cam should do, which is recording on power. But I also wanted to be able to turn the cameras off if need be in case of this. They flake out and I need to do a reboot or for whatever reason. If I have an always on type of 12-volt adapter, you're good. And if you don't want to run the cameras all night or run them all the time, of course you want the ability to turn them off, because as of 2015, most vehicles will have power that cuts off, but not all vehicles, especially US vehicles. A lot of times your 12-volt power 12-volt power sockets may still bleed off the battery. So that's still a trickle charge coming off the battery that wears it down. So dash cams are supposed to turn on when the vehicle turns on, turn off when the vehicle turns off. Getting a 12-volt adapter that an extender or an adapter that does let you turn the cameras off does save your battery, especially if it's just going to sit there and run all night. So that's the reason why I want to be able to remotely power the cameras down. And of course, less than $100. So the challenge was a retail or off-the-shelf solution without having to go to the internet for $100 or less to get everything above. And I accomplished it with what I got. And my solution was to roll my own. And in this case, it was the Pilot Dash Cam Mini, which I bought from Walmart. I bought two, $40 each, gave me $80. What the little camera is, it's based on the Novatek 220. Like I said, it's actually the C600 with a few little things thrown in, about $40 retail. It comes with a Novatek 96-220 camera, has 12 degrees field of view. 720 at 30 frames per second is actually the ideal I found. 1080 is actually an extrapolated, some people may say interpolated, but it's actually extrapolated from the 720p, because when you scale it down, you notice no real difference in the quality. The giveaway is you take 720 and you extrapolate that out on a video editor to 1080, and you really don't notice a difference in overall quality between 1080 and 720. So really, it's 720p is the native format. Extrapolated up to 1080, there really is no difference in the video size. And in fact, you will lose frame rate. So ideally, 720p is going to give you 30 frames per second. 1080p will give you maximum 24 frames per second. It's really just a handy thing if you just have to have it at 1080p because of display, it will do that. But you know, you're not really going to gain much in the way of clarity. So it kind of does it, but not really. And of course, because this is a lower powered chipset, the 200 base, it's going to be use MJPEG for lower power to try to get as little latency as possible on the video stream, using a generic AVI container, so it does give you universal playback. If your media player does not support MJPEG, you really need to consider getting a different video player, because this has been pretty much a standard for any editing or playback package since the late 90s. Of course, for power, I use the an Intercell 12-volt switched extender that I bought from Radio Shack a few years ago for something else. And I used a Go Extender 12-volt splitter from Walmart that I got for about 10 bucks. So prorated $12 for the Radio Shack component, because Radio Shack, of course, closed down a few months ago here in the States. Overall, it was about $100. So going to the tabletop, this is the basic setup. Of course, you have the camera. This was two cameras with the XT extender split. Power's not switched on here, so I had to go for an extender that does give you 12 volt with an extended. This gives you about 6 feet, and what I did is I ran this from the socket. Of course, with this switch, makes it handy to be able to turn on and off from the driver's seat. This sat under the driver's seat, and I'll cover the cameras now. Each camera came with a 3 meter, 10 foot power cable, mini USB. Does come with a mini USB data cable. It also came with a suction mount, which is pretty typical, but it also came with a bike mount, which I thought was kind of interesting. Looking at the camera itself, it does show that it has these 12 IR LEDs. I can never get them to work. There is no setting to turn them on or off. It's apparently on or off. Of course, 120 degree lens, 1.5 inch screen. Like I said, if you look up, sorry for the light level, there you go. It does show 1080p, 720 native, scales up to 1080, but like I said, with varying levels of quality and frame rate, all your regular buttons, power, mode, or menu, on off, okay. And this I thought was interesting, for select or for, this is mode and video lock, and of course multifunction buttons if you want sound on off. I'm not going to cover the menu structure. This is pretty typical of your Novatex. Of course, power on the side. Oh, and what also came with this particular camera was a 4GB Class 4 SD card. So, as a retail solution, a nice all-in-one. Here, of course, is the box sold by Pilot as the Mini, and I will cover that from the web, actually from the website Pilot Automotive. In this case, it was the CL 3002, came with 4GB. The 3004 would come with a 32GB, but you know, it just gives you up to a certain amount of storage as a bargain basement from Walmart. This particular camera was for $40. And of course, with options, which we'll cover in a little bit. This is just to show you the exact same camera from a spy store currently showing for $89. Not really worth it. A spattering of just generics. As you can see, price ranges, $30 here, $25 there, $22, $25. So a real wide variance. You should expect about $30 for the C 600. I would not pay much more than that. Like I said, this was purely as a retail. Online, you can expect cheaper prices, but your level of support, if you're just trying to get a throwaway camera, the $30 to $40 range is about what you should expect for a lower quality. You know, video codec supported on this chipset for the 96-220 is about 2 years old. And it's also in a lot of your knockoff G1W cameras. There are some giveaways in the timestamp, which you can see in this. So in this case, the Novatek 96-220, 120 field of view. Of course, I said 720p is its native resolution, does upscale to 1080p with lower frame rate, uses MJPEG, which does impact what you can record. So the good, of course, I got dual 120, about the minimum of what you should have in a dash cam to be able to cover the field of view of the driver. Of course, your visual field is up really 220, 230, but your focus is about 90 degrees. But so this gives a nice view of what you can expect from the front of the car or from the back. Video date time overlay is of course a plus to be able to record when incidents happen. It has good daytime, it's passable nighttime, but you will find out that, and I'll cover it in a minute, the video quality drops off as light levels decrease past about a, you know, cloudy, you know, really overcast day. That's about the lowest light level you'd want, otherwise the video starts to suffer in quality and frame rate. Of course, it has all the complements of what a dash cam supports: auto power on, motion detection, in this case it's redundancy. It came with a suction mount, which is what I used. The camera itself comes with a bike mount for this particular one, the Pilot Mini, and it came with an SD card. Plus, the fact that you could buy it retail means you have a return policy or a warranty to fall back on. So that's nice. The bad is, of course, poor performance in overcast, dusk, or dark conditions. And you can see that in other C600 cameras, videos that you'll find on YouTube and elsewhere. I'll cover that as the addendum video showing the different samples at 720 and 1080 in the different light conditions. And that's one thing to note, is the frame rate and the video quality will drop up substantially as light decreases after a certain level. 1080p is interpolated, so there really is no appreciable difference in 720p versus 1080p, other than the fact that it's just a larger image. But it's about the same quality, and you have less frame rate. So it's really, you know, flip a coin. You know, what do you want? Bigger pictures or smaller pictures with higher frame rate? I will tell you that frame rate drops off substantially if you have it in 1080p because it's working that cheap little processor far more. Even though it's using, and this covers the next thing, even though it's using MJPEG, which is for lower latency on lower power processors, that's what you find in common. It really is not an advantage in this case because dark in dark conditions, black is the hardest color for these cameras, for the processors to render. So as darker colors and black enters the frame of view, it's going to work a lot harder. And this particular, because it's using MJPEG, a very inefficient low latency codec, it's going to give you about 4 hours of record time depending upon frame rate and everything, for a maximum 4 hours about on a 32 gig card. Don't expect much more. Again, compared to other cameras, for example, the 0801, which I use, I can get up to about 6 hours, but you shouldn't expect much more on a camera like this. So, you know, scale back your expectations as you pay less money. You must manually integrate. I must have to pull the front and back video feeds because this is not an integrated unit. So don't expect anything in this price range, you know, unless you get a 720 with a standard definition rear camera integrated unit. You know, if you want HD on front and back, you're going to have to use individual cameras. This is what you can expect for $100 or less. But remember, more stuff equals more complicated. You know, on the positive, hey, you know, redundancy. If one breaks, you have another one just like it. Just pull it off the back or vice versa. The not so ugly, I'm at my budget. $100 for front and back and HD recording for passable video. It did support motion detection, but it was not recommended while it's driving. In particular, motion detection while I was driving chops up video to between 15 seconds and a minute. And really just made the video unusable. So I left motion detection off. I would recommend motion detection if this camera was to be used as a passive security, you know, to watch the back of, say, the bed of the truck or the storage compartment, and it sat in the dark, and if somebody opened the back cab or whatever and it caught them, then this would actually be a camera maybe to be used for that. Otherwise, I would turn video detection and G-sensor off and just let it record, and just remember that, hey, if something like an accident happened, of course I know that I have my dash cam, I would remember to pull the camera off. If you totally forget that you have the dash cam, you know, for the instances like this, then you really shouldn't have one, because this is why you have it, so you can pull it in the event that something happens. If you just totally are oblivious and let it record on, then, well, you know what, you might as well not have a dash cam at all. Just save yourself the money if you're going to forget it's there. Can turn off or reboot cameras if needed without stopping. That was the nice thing about having my particular solution, very similar to my $300 solution that I run. This was just a test and to see what I could pull off for $100. To show you the actual installation, here's the camera, of course, behind the rearview mirror. It's going to be next to what I have is my permanent solution over here. Here's another view. My 0801 is actually on this side. So I put this, what I found interesting is that suction cup actually held even in this very stippled surface. So it really held on even in heat and cold changes. So I felt that was kind of nice. I could, of course, have moved it up a little further. I just wanted to be able to kind of see the edge to make sure that the camera was on, was recording. Here's an example of where I had it in the back. Of course, if I really wanted to, I could mount a little bit closer and I could hide the cable a little bit better. Here's what it looked like from the outside. That's why it hung around like it did, because this was just a quick and dirty installation. I wasn't trying to make it permanent. And this is a view to actually show the camera placement relative to the rear screen, the rear view mirror, you know, that it hides behind it. Relative to where my 0801 is, of course, this is center, so I can't, not without obscuring this view, but it still gave me a good placement. Here, of course, is the back that you can't see at all because I have a little bit of tint on the back. And this is the shared power. Just to give you an idea, of course, you know, the cable went off unobtrusively below the driver's seat and powered the splitter, so I could turn the system on and off as needed if the cameras flaked out for whatever reason. So I hope this gives you a good little review of the C600, and my little project. Like I said, maybe you can try it on your own. You know, is it worth the money? Maybe not. The video samples will follow on a concurrent video. Thank you very much.